Our next speaker, Susan Brady, is the chair of this phenomenal institute, lead strategist of Linkage's Advancing Women in Inclusion Practice, a principal consultant, and executive vice president at Linkage. And if you're wondering how much I see her because of all these roles, it is more online and via phone than it is in person with all of those roles. She is outstanding. In 1999, Ms. Brady co-founded Linkage's Women in Leadership Summit. And prior to rejoining Linkage in her current role, she worked with two spin-offs of the Harvard Negotiation Project, where she coached executives and led strategic marketing and business development initiatives. Here's the coolest part. In the last year, she's become an author. She's the author of The 30-Second Guide to Coaching Your Inner Critic and contributing author of Enlightened Power, How Women Are Transforming the Path to Leadership. And in 2014, very rightfully so, Susan Brady was named one of the women worth watching by Profiles in Diversity Journal magazine. Most importantly, as a direct report of hers, I have the distinct pleasure of taking in her wisdom, her humor, and her kindness on a daily basis. She is one of the best people I know, and I'm so grateful to have the honor of being in her life. Please join me in welcoming Linkage's very own Susan Brady to the stage.
Good morning. I am so happy to be waking up with all of you. Welcome to day two, and welcome to the Women in Leadership Institute. Gosh, it's an exciting time. We're going to explore this morning what it means to understand ourself and how that impacts our advancement as women leaders. But first, I want to tell you a little bit about Linkage's research and Linkage's role in the development of leaders worldwide, just so that we're all clear about this, because there's been some confusion. It turns out that in order to develop leaders, right, you need the competencies, skills, knowledge, education, exposure, and experience in order to succeed. We've done this for almost three decades at Linkage and in every country in the world on every continent. It actually isn't different for men and women. How you develop a great leader is how you develop a great leader. The only problem, and here's the catch, is we have an advancement challenge on our hands. So, like Rachel said yesterday, we have endeavored to try to figure out, okay, we know what good leadership looks like. We know how to develop leaders who can drive superior results. What's going on? Well, the first step we found is for companies to admit there is a problem. If you are here, they have. Doesn't mean they're solving it yet, but they're starting to, right? And we found that there are two things every organization needs to do after they admit there's a problem. And by the way, admitting there's a problem goes something like this. I've got 50% of my talent pool, and they're women, and I've got 10% in the senior echelons of my leadership ranks. Problem. 35% of my organization's talent pool are people of color, and I got 3% in positions of leadership. Problem. Gotta admit there's a problem first, then you gotta do two things. So in the past 2 years, we have really worked to figure out how can we make a dent in the advancement of women and the advancement of every underrepresented population in organizations today. What do they have to do? We found two things. The first is really external to us. You know, our experience this week is really about us as women leaders. Right? The first external situation is really the culture in which we work, the cultures in which we work. And the to-do is to drive an inclusive and engaging environment. So turns out the way to drive and create cultures of inclusion really involves understanding what inclusive leadership looks like. Because there's no such thing as changing a culture, there's only such thing as changing the people in it. And so we've developed some clarity around the competencies, skills, and tools needed to understand what it means to lead inclusively. And we're so excited by the response of this work and the helpfulness of it, we embedded it in your experience this week. So you will all be going through an inclusive leadership competency session to learn more about that. That is external. However, we all get to think of ourselves as inclusive leaders as well. So you'll learn about yourself. But really, that's one thing. Organizations need to take on creating an environment, addressing the bias, addressing the unconsciousness, and having everybody engage. It's also, by the way, why there are 45 men in a room down the hall doing a very experimental, sort of risky thing. We're sort of testing it with some of our best and brightest clients, inviting their men to talk about, ready for this, what it's like to be a man in the world of advancing women leaders. I still want to be a fly on that wall, but I wasn't invited. But anyway, so they're all men down the hall. If you see them, that's some of them are doing that in the next 2 days. And that's about this picture. That's external. The other thing we got to do is the internal job. The internal is internal to us. And that's where understanding self comes in. So we have embarked on a study and looked at over 3,000 women. We've polled hundreds and hundreds of women at a time. We've talked to people in diversity and inclusion, talent development, leadership development, human resources, at well over half the Fortune 500. And we've pored over our aggregate data, both self-assessments of the Women in Leadership Institute data and the 360s. And what we found, interestingly enough, is that there's some common themes. I'm going to review these hurdles. And you can follow along with me. You have a little cheat sheet on your table that gives you sort of the headlines of this study. This morning, I'm going to run through the seven, explain a little bit about them, the question and the shift, and then I'm going to dive in to the first. But first, let me say a little bit about hurdles. So hurdles are obstacles you cross while running full speed ahead. If you get tripped up on one, I'm told, I'm not a track runner, so I actually have never jumped an actual hurdle, but I'm told if you trip on one, you go down. You go down. So you need to get over all of them. And hurdles aren't that high. They're just a few feet. And so what I'm going to posit is that with practice and purposeful intention, we can master and cross skillfully and even triumphantly the hurdles that I'm going to present. Okay, the first one, confidence. Can I do this? Look, there's a lot of research about confidence. This is what we're going to dive deeper on today. And what our research pointed to is it's not just about confidence. Do we need to build confidence as women? You bet. It's not the only job to be done. Actually, what we need to do first is think about our worthiness. So we're going to talk about that. Our view on this at Linkage is we want to shift the conversation from just being about confidence, because that's important too, to building first our capacity for worthiness and coaching our inner critic. So that was number one. The second thing our research pointed to as one of the big hurdles to advancement is around branding and presence. Not probably surprising to you, there's been a lot of talk on branding as well, but this is how am I showing up? You know, what are people saying about me when I leave the room, right? And what's really interesting is that a lot of women are uncomfortable talking about what they're good at. And, you know, yesterday, Rachel got away with one question, a strength, and you all got up and skillfully told someone you've never met a strength. I have to tell you, I'm really attracted to the idea of superpower. You know, strength is like so yesterday. Like today, you've got superpowers, okay? And they're plural. You have more than one. And by the way, they're not driving results and engaging fully. Everyone in this room, actually, according to our data, knows how to drive results and engage fully. Those can be your superpowers, but I'm going to ask you go deeper, look harder, examine, because you've got something special you're bringing, and then it's our job to tell everyone about it in a skillful way. But the shift here is from assuming that others will promote our value to taking charge of our personal brand. It's our responsibility. The third hurdle our research pointed to is around ambivalence. You know, I just gave a talk at a financial institution not too long ago and asked, raise your hand if you know what your next professional step is. Out of 100, oh, you're actually doing it. That's great. So let's just see if this statistically works. If you know what your next professional step is, raise your hand. All right, I have the view of the room. I'm going to give you a 40% take, 30% take. What we found is out of 100 women, 3 women raised their hand. Okay, so trick question, whose job is it to know what we want? It's actually not our spouses or our boss. As a matter of fact, it's our own. So the shift here is thinking that someone's gonna figure it out for us to taking seriously the job of knowing what we want. So networking. Time and time again, what comes up is that we women get credit for relationship building, and at the same time, we think of networking as optional, right? You know, I'm not gonna go to that networking event, I just have too much to do. Right? So the shift here is, and who has the time, right? That's the question. The shift here is going from a moment of thinking that networking is optional to realizing as women and in our journey of advancement, we're talking strategic business priority. Last I checked, most of us, myself included, worked for a man. And when that man walks to the bathroom with another man, they're networking. This is happening. When men network with each other, they don't call it networking. They just go do stuff together. And don't kid yourself. When they connect over some silly thing, an article they just read, or you know, a conversation they just had, they're influencing each other. We need to orchestrate more opportunity for us to strategically influence the dialogue in our organizations and take this seriously. We can change the name. We don't have to call it networking if you people don't like networking, but we have to do more of it. Okay, the fifth hurdle is making the ask, and this is well-researched, far before Linkage overlaid our own research on it, and this is, how do I ask for what I want? It is fairly stunning when you look at the data about how uncomfortable we are making requests on our own behalf. For fear, we might actually be seen as somewhat self-serving. And this isn't just around salary, that's not it. This is also, my friends, this is also micro-requests. Like, honey, can you drop the dog off because I gotta get to work, right? It's like, no, I'm just gonna like overrow the boat and I'm gonna drop the dog off and I'm gonna like be mad as I do it because that's what I do. So the shift here is putting off what we think of as self-serving requests, even though we also like to control, and asking often for what we want. Okay, the next hurdle is my personal favorite. I think that I've got like a black belt in this, and here's what it is. It is proving our value. So, hey, listen, I'll just take on more, and I'm gonna overrow the boat. I love the metaphor of overrowing the boat because it goes like this, right? You're sitting there and you're like, oh, sure, I can take that one on. You can put that on the boat. It's really heavy. My boat sinks down. I'm gonna sort of row a little harder. And then more and more and more. And I'm like, and hey, did you guys see? I got a lot on my boat. I'm working really hard. Don't you see? Like, big effort. Yeah, how's that going for us? How is that going for us? Let me tell you, overcompensating, over-delivering, doing it ourselves, taking it on too much, making it all perfect, we just have to admit, let's face it, we like to control a little. The name of the game, if you want to advance as a woman leader, is you have to start to multiply. And that is no easy task for those of us who have mastered, by this point in our career, over-rowing the boat. But here's what happens when we overrow the boat, right? We send wicked ripples that we don't intend, and we get tired. I've met more women who are like, gosh, I'm so happy to be here, I'm tired. I'm like, that's because you're overrowing the boat. That's why you're tired. I am too. Okay, so the shift, by the way, the shift on this is from putting, from proving ourselves to scaling and multiplying our impact. My question to you is, how are you multiplying your impact? And it is not doing it all yourself. It can't be. Okay, the last hurdle. The last hurdle could be considered foundational. It also could be considered the first hurdle, and this is around bias. There's a ton of research now about unconscious bias. I think the men down the hall are gonna be confronted with their own bias, like, you know, when they're asked to dress business casual for men, it's like, do I wear the stone-colored khakis or the khaki-colored khakis? Right? For us, like, think about how many many options we have for business casual, right? Like you know, there's no man gonna be like, I should have worn the stone khakis. They don't understand how easy it is to dress business casual. So look, there's a lot of bias and a lot going on in our culture today, and we're beginning to really pay attention to that, but this hurdle is not about that. This hurdle is what our partners at Orange Grove have partnered with Linkage to help to get cracked down on. You're also gonna dive into this hurdle this week, and it's really about our own bias. Right, what beliefs and assumptions as women have we bought into that limit our own advancement? One could argue we might have an assumption about all of these hurdles that have limited our advancement that we want to question, which is why we gave you questions. So take those questions with you today, take them back into your learning teams and dive in. We start with confidence, because if you don't tackle this hurdle first, I'm not sure the rest of them really matter. If we don't think we got what it takes and the people around us have what it takes, I don't think the rest of the hurdles really matter. So, and it, by the way, it's a cottage industry. There's a lot being said. If only women could build their self-confidence. We got stats to prove it, though. Look, there's a problem. You know, the Institute of Management and Leadership had a study, and 50% of women managers reported self-doubt in their performance and careers. Less than 30% of men did. Carnegie Mellon did a very popular study. I talk about this a lot. Turns out men negotiate their salaries 4 times as often as we women. And when we do negotiate, we ask for 30% less. I just have to tell you, you know, it's not in my interest as a woman to say this, but let's just call a truth here. The disparity between the male-female dollar, bias or our responsibility? Potentially both, right? The Hewlett-Packard did a great study and looked at the people that applied for promotions to internal jobs and found that women who applied believed they'd have to have 100% of the qualifications listed for the job. Right? So we're over rowing our boat, proving our value. It's like, don't they see that I can do this? And then we're like, when we do see it, it's like, oh, I can't do that yet. I can't do that yet. I haven't done that yet. Turns out men are happy to take the job if they have 60% of the job requirements. Okay, it is not business specific. We go to another sector and look at the government, and we see the Women in Politics Institute at American University did a study, and this man saddens me. Women with the same resumes self-assess as less qualified to run than their male counterparts. Same education, same internships, same grades. What? So there's something going on. Let's look a little bit deeper. Confidence, definition, the belief that you can do it. Is it important to believe that you can do it? Yes. But I would argue it's only part of the equation. Worthiness is a favorable estimate or opinion of oneself or another. Here's the difference. Confidence you build, confidence you can fake. Confidence is about taking action. Right, you can feel confident for periods of time without feeling worthy. That's called faking it until you make it. That's imposter syndrome. Worthiness, you are. It's a state of being. It's a belief. It's not something you fake. And it's not something you go out and achieve. It is something you are just because. And the good news is, if you feel innately worthy, it will help your confidence. It will help your confidence. So let's pause. So just tracking here. First of all, it's 8 o'clock in the morning. Second of all, there's some of you here who are like, I need another cup of coffee. This woman talks fast and loud. there are a lot of voices. So the way looking at it, I got 750 friends, right? But the truth is I really have about 5,000. And the reason I have 5,000 is because every single one of you has several voices running around in your head. And yeah, like the one that's like, what voices? What voices? I don't have a voice. You should have a voice. I don't have a voice. Yeah, that voice, those voices. And welcome to your inner voice. I have to tell you, Disney is here today and has women here today. Hello, Disney. Pixar did it right when they launched Inside Out. I'm going to show a trailer to Inside Out. Here's the thing. If you haven't seen this movie, go see this movie. Because this is what this generation is growing up understanding while we're like, inner voice. So take a look. Can we play the clip?
So, how was the first day of school?
It was fine, I guess. I don't know.
Do you ever look at someone and wonder what is going on inside their head?
Did you guys pick up on that?
Sure did.
Something's wrong.
We're gonna find out what's happening, but we'll need support. Signal the husband.
Harry, all the way! All the way!
Uh-oh, she's looking at us. What did she say?
What? Oh, sorry, sir. No one was listening.
Is it garbage night? We left the toilet seat up. What? What is it, woman? What?
Signal him again.
Ah, so, Riley, how was school?
Oh,
you gotta be kidding me.
For this, we gave up that Brazilian helicopter pilot?
School was great, all right?
What was that? I thought you said we were gonna act casual.
Riley, is everything okay?
Sir, she just rolled her eyes at us.
All right, make a show of force. I don't want to have to put the foot down.
No, not the foot.
Riley, I do not like this new attitude.
Oh, I'll show you attitude, old
no,
man.
No, breathe.
What is your problem? Just leave me alone.
Sir, reporting high levels of sass.
Take it to DEFCON 2.
DEFCON 2.
I don't know where this disrespectful attitude came from.
You want a piece of this, Pops?
Yeah, well, look.
Prepare the foot.
Keys to safety position. Ready to launch on your command, sir.
Just shut up!
Fire!
That's it. Go to your room.
The foot is down. The foot is down.
Woo!
Good job, gentlemen. That could have been a disaster.
Well, that was a disaster.
Come, fly with me, Gachinha.
A major emotion picture? Oh my goodness. Gina Davis is going to talk about Hollywood, and they are making strides. Thank you, Pixar, for giving us this movie. And let me just tell you that major emotion picture, the topic this morning is understanding self. And the premise of understanding self came from the work of some of the people I used to work with at a company called Vantage, and Sheila Heen, Doug Stone, and Bruce Patton, who came up with the following, and I think it is absolutely brilliant. What we think and feel drives what we say and do. What we think and feel drives what we say and do. There's a lot of leadership development, communications work, lots of work on the say-do part. Listen, speak lower. Now that Sheila Heen told me that I don't sound like I do, it explains like so much about my life. what we think and feel drives what we say and do, and there is a rampant worthiness antagonist. And I would say our worthiness antagonist, as we think about what we think and feel drives what we say and do, is the inner critic. Okay, so now I'm going to explain to you what the inner critic is. I am going to introduce you to my inner critic, and then I am going to show you a way out. So let's talk about how this whole thing works. But first, I got to tell you why we care. So the inner critic is the voice in our head that is critical of ourselves and critical of others. Ourselves and others. Okay, it's a little bit of a misnomer to call it the inner critic because I think everybody would think, oh, that's like that little voice inside my head that doesn't like myself. Actually, it's that little voice inside your head that doesn't like yourself and then thinks that you are better than somebody else. We all do this, by the way. We're just, to be human is to do what I'm going to describe to you. Look, the problem is it assaults our sense of self-worth and our sense of worthiness of others. And the reason we tackle this hurdle first is because we are causing someone else unnecessary pain, and or we are causing ourselves unnecessary pain. So I am really in the pain mitigation business, masked by the advancing women leaders business, masked by the leadership development business, if you're tracking. This is pain mitigation work that we need to do first and foremost in order to advance. So let me tell you how this works. Let me take you inside the critic. Okay, the premise we start with is that we, on a good day, a good moment, we get out of bed, it's a bright sunny day, we feel great, we get a workout in, we go down to have breakfast, we feel great, you know, our kids or the people we live with, they're happy too. Everything's hunky-dory. We're coming from a place of, I'm enough and I matter, you're enough and I matter, I respect myself, I respect you, we're good, we're compassionate, we are enough, I feel enough, and I'm same as. So the premise of the center place is the hand that I extend to you is one that assumes I'm bringing something to the table and you are bringing something to the table. Full stop. Okay? That means that if you're the president of the United States or if you're the person that cleaned the bathroom in your hotel room, what you're gonna get from me on a good day at a good moment, hopefully more often than not, is respect. I see you. I make eye contact with you. You are of value, right? That's a good moment, good day. And it comes from a place of believing that I am enough and I matter, and you are enough and you matter. And understanding that we are all perfectly imperfect. Absolutely perfectly imperfect. I don't know who decided, you know, first it's like, oh my God, we have to all be perfect, and then, oh my gosh, we have to show our vulnerability. Who on earth wants to, like, we've worked hard. Who wants to show weakness? I don't. Except, here's the thing, you know, when I mess up, people know. They see. We're not kidding anybody. When we are at center, we are enough. Okay, and then what happens? Well, life happens. And what we've got here is the one voice of all the voices, the one voice of all the voices that Pixar calls disgust. I call harshness. Harshness, the voice of harshness. So what happens is the energy is here, and when it's pointed at ourselves, it is shame. We know what shame feels like. Shame feels bad. We call this one down. We call this shame, feeling less than. And it goes something like this, when the energy of contempt and harshness is faced at us. I shouldn't have worn this outfit today. I should really stop talking. Oh, I should have spoken up in that meeting. Oh, I was supposed to get that done. I cannot believe I didn't do that, right? These are the voices that tell you, you suck. Any questions? And you know what? It doesn't feel good. Shame hurts us. Shame hurts us. Shame doesn't necessarily hurt the people around you unless you're in a loving relationship. It's very hard to love somebody who's in shame. Shame hurts us, right? It's not fun. Okay, so we know that. So the energy of contempt and harshness is faced at us. When the energy of contempt and harshness moves out to the rest of the world, your shoulds and shouldn'ts and supposed to's become about them. She should not wear that. He should really stop, because he doesn't know what he's talking about. Wow, she was supposed to get that done. I can't believe she didn't do that. The energy is looking our nose down on others, and it's fundamentally grandiosity at its core. People ask me a lot, so wait a minute, you're telling me that we all have moments of grandiosity daily, and does that mean I'm a narcissist? The answer is no. It is not narcissism. All narcissists are grandiose, but all grandiosity is not narcissism. Because to be human is to be grandiose at times. And here's the funny thing about grandiosity. It feels great. Here's what feels great. How many people like to be right? Anyone? Oh, that's like 100%. Okay, so when we are right and standing in our all-knowingness, our self-righteousness, when we are right, we feel great. What's the problem here? Okay? Like, if everybody would just listen to me, it would all be running smoothly, right? So grandiosity feels bad to people around us. It feels bad to people around us, okay? And the reason it feels bad to people around us is because it's obnoxious. even if we don't say it. So interesting, we're about to embark on some research about the difference between men and women at work and how they show up, one up. And I have a theory, which is today a theory, which is that men exhibit more grandiosity explicitly at work, and women exhibit it implicitly. Here are the implications for us. We feel it off of each other. Like, I think she just looked me up and down. But we're all too polite to actually be like, there is a lot of grandiosity. I just think we're in culture to be a little bit more refined with it. Some of us aren't. Some of us aren't. So look, here's the thing. We bounce between the two. We bounce between the two. And which means we wake up in a good place, in a good moment. I'm enough and I matter. You're enough and you matter. And then we go off on our day and something happens. Maybe we pull out on the street and someone rolls down the window and tells us off because we didn't mean to. We cut them off. We're going to, depending upon how you're wired, you're going to shoot down into, oh my gosh, I'm really sorry I didn't cut you off. Or if you're like my husband, you'll roll down your window too and give him a piece of your mind. It's either going one up or one down. Okay, so how many people here play basketball or have played in their lifetime? Show of hands. Oh, that's a good group. Okay, so I am barefoot, 5'11". Today, probably 6'1". And if I had a dollar for every man in business in my career who has asked me if I played basketball, I'd be able to buy you all new shoes. The problem is I don't play basketball. And I guess it's not a problem. You know, it's just not my thing. I kind of understood it when I have a very, very tall teenage daughter. When she was in fifth grade, she was vertically advantaged. And she could shoot a hoop from anywhere on the court. The problem was, like, she didn't get in the game. I'm like, honey, you gotta hustle. Like, here am I, like, I've never played basketball. Like, you gotta get in there, right? You gotta really hustle. Like, who cares? Hip chuck. Do what you have to do. Get the ball. And she's like, Mom, it's rude. Fair. I felt like that, you know, that clip in Grease. It's like long distance running. We'll choose a different sport for Caroline Brady. So here's the thing. If we right now decided, let's do several pickup games of basketball, and you were some of the lucky people that had me on your team, you would quickly learn that I can't play. And while I am playing basketball poorly with some of you who are like college athletics, you know, basketball stars, it is my job to hold myself in warm regard while I build my confidence playing basketball. So you don't get to be better than me when we're playing basketball just because I'm horrible at basketball. You get to be a better basketball player. See the difference? And while you are the better basketball player and I am the less skilled basketball player, I get to feel enough while I'm learning. It's going to be uncomfortable. It doesn't give you the right to look down your nose at me, and it doesn't give me permission to go into shame about how I'm not good enough because I don't play basketball. Okay? Okay. So the energy of the critic is disgust. We bounce, and harshness, we bounce from pointing it at ourselves to pointing it at others, and up and down we go. Let me just say right now, I think one of the kind of interesting distinctions of this work is to know that we're talking about human beings. Human beings are different than human resources. I'm sure all of you could make a short list right now of human beings that are the wrong human resource for the job, okay? And what we're talking about, and that's true, by the way, you know, and what I'm gonna posit to you is that you can treat your human beings that you work with a lot of respect even while you manage them out of one resourced role into another or out of the company. So this is how we show up and how we understand ourselves in relationship to others so that we can be skillful in relationship. But boy, are we critical. We are critical. So while I do think that there is rampant, implicit grandiosity among us women, I get the advantage of hearing, you know, women's internal voices. Now, I'm not like psychic. I'm not hearing all yours right now. Thank God. That'd be like really noisy. I get the advantage of working with women executives and hearing their inner dialogue, and it's critical, right? But we do know what we really got to also work on is our shame. So Look, Dove does it right. We're going to show you a quick clip.
I'm a forensic artist. Worked for the San Jose Police Department from 1995 to 2011.
I showed up to a place I'd never been, and there was a guy with a drafting board.
We couldn't see them, they couldn't see us.
Tell me about your hair.
I didn't know what he was doing, but then I could tell after several questions that he was drawing me.
Tell me about your chin.
It kind of protrudes a little bit, especially when I smile.
Your jaw?
My mom told me I had a big jaw.
What would be your most prominent feature?
I kind of have a fat, rounder face.
The older I've gotten, the more freckles I've gotten.
I would say I have a pretty big forehead.
Once I get a sketch, I say thank you very much, and then they leave. I don't see them.
All I had been told before the sketch was to get friendly with this other woman, Chloe.
Today I'm gonna ask you some questions about a person you met earlier, and I'm gonna ask you some general questions about their face.
She was thin, so you could see her cheekbones. And her chin, it was a nice, thin chin.
She had nice eyes. They lit up when she spoke.
Cute nose.
She had blue eyes, very nice blue eyes.
So here we are. This is the sketch that you helped me create. And that's a sketch that somebody described of you.
So yeah, that's...
She looks closed off and fatter, sadder too. Mm-hmm. The second one looks more open, friendly, and happy.
Mm-hmm. I should be more grateful of my natural beauty. It impacts the choices and the friends that we make, the jobs we apply for, how we treat our children. It impacts everything. It couldn't be more critical to your happiness.
Do you think you're more beautiful than you say?
Yeah. Yeah.
We spend a lot of time as women analyzing and trying to fix the things that aren't quite right. And we should spend more time appreciating the things that we do like.
Thank you, Dove, right? 25 years ago, an author named Marianne Williamson wrote a book of woman's worth, and in it she said, we are tyrannized by the belief that we are inadequate. Did you happen to notice yesterday in the assessment sessions that for those who have 360 assessment, that on every single competency we underrated ourselves compared to how our raters rated us? This is not in our service. It's not in your service to do that. I mean, a few of you are just smart assessment takers and you don't want to overrate yourselves. That's not bad. The rest of you actually were surprised. Oh, wow. I heard words like, wow, I'm really appreciative. Wow, I'm really surprised. God, I'm grateful. That's so nice. Yeah, you know why? Because you're awesome. That's why. Let's get with the program here, people. Look, so now I'm going to introduce you to my awesome inner critic. And she is, you know, there's a reason I'm an expert in the inner critic, and you're about to find out why. Okay, so I think the best way to do this is to draw on pieces of feedback. And since yesterday's theme was feedback, I'm going to share a couple stories about the gift of feedback. The first one, all of my stories are true. I have way too much material than what I could cover right now. And the first story is something that happened a while back where I have a colleague who invites me to be a visiting lecturer at a Boston area university every fall. And I do two 90-minute classes for her graduate-level students, behavioral psychology, about grandiosity and shame. And about relationship and negotiation and conflict management, what have you. I've done this a couple times before for her, but I hadn't seen her since she was at this event a few years prior. And I went and I did my talk, and she came up to me after and she said, "Susan, have you gotten a speaking coach since the last time I saw you?" And I said, "Actually, no." She says, "Really?" And I said, "Really, yeah, but, so do you know, maybe, like, what I did differently? Like, is there, like, a thing you can put your finger on? Because I really would like to know." She's like, "Oh, yes, I can tell you. I can tell you very clearly. I mean, it is, like, clear as day. The last time I saw you, you were in front of 700, 600 people, and you were emceeing. You know, you were running the 4 days. And, you know, you're on these big screens, and the whole time you kept, like, flipping your hair, like, all over the place. And you have a lot of hair, right? And so, like, back this way and up this way and all that. And today, you didn't flip your hair." At which time, I stand and say, "Thank you so much. Thank you." And then here's what happens while I am standing there saying thank you. Energy of contempt. Whoosh. I'm a hair flipper. I flipped my hair in front of 750 people. I'm here for my company, trying to build credibility for our brand and elegantly host this event and our clients, and I played with my hair, and that's what she remembered? Oh my God. Pause. Energy of contempt. Who on earth gives feedback like that? I mean, have you gotten a speaking coach? She should know better than that. She teaches this. Pause. Energy of contempt, shame. Clearly, I have an unconscious tick, and I should stop speaking in the public altogether. It is not what I meant to do. I want to crawl under a rock. I'm a hair flipper. Pause. You know, she's got some pretty big hair herself. Can I introduce you to maybe a keratin treatment to treat your fluff? Mean. Pause and back down again. Until I'm done with my little bounce and I practice what I preach and I notice, like, oh, the whole time, thank you so much, right? Until I say, wait. Susan, get a grip. First, you gotta pause. Gotta pause the dialogue, because your little disgust voice, contempt voice, your little inner critic just took the microphone and went bananas. She was having a party. And so, I first, while I'm looking at this woman, who is lovely and who trusts in me to come and speak to her classes, who just told me maybe I should wear my hair up. I had it in a bun that day, by the way. That's why I didn't flip it, and so note to self. I have to say, okay, Suze, okay, come down off your self-righteous high horse. She has pretty blonde hair. It's not too fluffy. Maybe she could use a carrot. Okay, no, come down. I mean it. You need to, get off your self-righteous high horse and just, it's okay. It's helpful feedback. And to you, oh, little miss never wants to talk in public again, your voice is needed. Stop the nonsense and come back in. And only when I come back up into compassionate center can I get clear that maybe when I talk in public, I should put my hair back. Okay, so I'm not at risk of playing with my hair, and I don't ever speak publicly with my hair down. And I could have gone bananas for a long time and remained a hair flipper, or stopped speaking. And I practiced this work. It took me about 30 seconds. I got myself in. It's a silly example, but it's a meaningful one, and it's actually a true one, and I learned from it. My mantra is, I'm enough and I matter, and in this case, so is she, right? So the part of me that experiences shame and that is going to town on myself needs to pull myself back into warm regard. And the part of me that's going to town on the other person, whoever the other person is like, okay, come on down. That person matters too, and it's not okay. We are no longer at respect, right? Same as. Okay. About half a year ago, not even, I was traveling with a colleague who I have a lot of respect for, and we were doing some work with clients, and we were out to dinner. This is like 2 days. We've been working together. And halfway through dinner, over a glass of wine, she said, Susan, can I give you some feedback? Now, I gotta tell you, if you know, I have this theory that actually everybody's internal voice at that moment goes, no! But I was like, of course, yes. Yeah, of course, yes. And so what she said to me, was, I just want you to know that there are people in the office who are overwhelmed by you and scared by you. They find you a little intense and like scary intense. And there are people in the office who think you think it's about you. It's about your agenda. And I thought, wow, okay. So I'm sitting there at dinner and I'm hearing this feedback. And where I went was the following. It was not one down into shame. And it was not initially attacking her. Where I went with my disgust and harshness and contempt, I would say, is pointing out into the universe. And it went something like this in my head. If you had my job, you'd be intense too. You have no idea what it takes to get stuff done around here. I mean, have you ever had, you know, the launch of a brand new product and questioning some thinking and formulating it, bringing it to market, making it commercially viable is not for the faint of heart. While I'm doing it, I'm like slapping my hand. And I'm like, oh. But I wrestled with this one for a few days, you know? And of course they're gonna think it's all about me because I'm driving to making results and I'm trying to, you know, innovate and I'm wanting everybody to come along. And when people don't come along, we got milestones, we got goals, we gotta go, we gotta move. Time is now. That's intense. Could I tone it down a little, maybe? So then I remember also another very trusted dear friend and colleague introduced me for a keynote a couple years ago, and one of the things she said about me in my introduction was that I was a force of nature. And at the time, I'm like, oh, that's so nice, force of nature. Overwhelming the boat, force of nature. What I then did was what any responsible adult would do. I Google imaged force of nature. And what I found was that So apparently working with me at Linkage can be like being in the eye of, I'm like the eye of my very own storm, a tornado, pick your one, tidal wave, hurricane. I suddenly had images of my colleagues, like when poor Rachel is like, I don't see her very much. I'm like, she's kind of lucky because, you know, I do this shit. So I have this image of coming into the office and sometimes like, she's coming. Foul weather gear, everyone, hold on to the, you know, it's like, oh God. I had to get to a point where it's like, I don't need to be that intense. I certainly don't want people to be scared of me, you know? And my friends, what this is giving myself permission to show up however I want to show up because it's absolutely in my ethos to get it done. So have I let my focus drive impact and send ripples that impact others and remained not only unconscious of it, but I'm dismissed the impact on others. And I teach this work, okay? My point in telling you this is we gotta practice. This is a practice of being more aware of how we're showing up. Understanding yourself is being more aware about how we show up. And so I do what I preach. I practice what I preach. If you know me, I mean it. I walk my talk. I gotta push pause on this whole conversation, on this whole rationalizing why sometimes I need to be the eye of my own storm. Let me tell you, Jamie Brady, Caroline Brady, Abby Brady also feel the storm. How we do anything is how we do everything. We're actually not that complicated as human beings. How you show up is how you show up. So I know if I'm the eye of my own storm at work, I am for sure the eye of my own storm at home. And oh my gosh, I need to take a breath and apologize to the people who I've impacted. So I have a few colleagues in the audience today, and I just want to take this official opportunity to apologize for any storm debris I have left in your wake. So, but I gotta do this. I gotta look at compassion at center. I gotta come down from my high horse of justifying the bad behavior. And I have to say, I care more about the impact it has on others than about driving my own agenda. And by the way, it's gonna be a moment-to-moment practice, because if this was easy for me, I would already be doing it. If some of the things you're gonna look at that you need to change were easy for you, you'd already be doing it. This is hard stuff, guys. This is second awareness, second consciousness. This is pausing long enough to say, I'm not gonna be like crazy intense at this meeting. I'm gonna breathe, right? So I gotta bring myself up from my one down, bring myself down from my one up, and hold myself in warm regard, and hold the people I work with in warm regard, so that we can do this business, right? Okay. In this case, the mantra, they come first. Noticing our own grandiosity is so much harder than noticing our own shame, because shame feels bad. Grandiosity feels fine until we're introduced to it, and then we either want to fight it or we go into shame about it. By the way, I think that the reason why we are in a dearth of feedback right now, why there isn't a lot of coaching for development, is because I think we intuitively sense that when we give feedback, we're contending with this bounce. And the only thing worse, when you tell someone some negative feedback, than having them cry in your office, is to have them go one up and tell you you're wrong. We don't want to deal with it. And then we have our own bounce. So a couple years ago, I was invited to go to Miami to work with 12 Latin American men on the topic of conflict-savvy leadership. But what I really knew I was going to do is talk about grandiosity and shame and the bounce, because I do think good leadership starts with understanding self. And so I didn't know if this thing was going to organ reject or not. I'm dealing with Latino machismo men, and they're all CEOs of the businesses they run in different countries for this global organization. And I got down there, and it was 3 days, and they were fabulous. I was nervous, and they worked with me, and they rolled up their sleeves, and we talked about our grandiosity, and we talked about the impact on others, and I really actually think that they got something out of it. And so I flew home to Boston, and which has never happened to me before. I got in early, and I was feeling good. I was feeling like, gosh, you know, if I have to leave my kids and I have to travel for the work that I do in the world, I'm so glad that I can do something meaningful. And I knew I was going to arrive in time to go pick up my kids at school. At the time, my daughter, Abigail, was in first grade, and Caroline was in third. And I drive up, and they jump in the car. And I've been gone for, a total of, 4 days at this point. And Abby Brady jumps in the car, and she says, Mama, today was end-of-year writer celebration, and Sarah's dad brought her flowers, and Eli's mom brought chocolates even though she wasn't supposed to, and I didn't have anyone there for me. Okay. So, I'm driving in my car, and my kid, who I haven't seen in 4 days, just tells me she was alone during a celebration and a meaningful one. I actually don't know how I got my kids home safely, because I went to a place in my mind that I'm about to introduce you to, but I wasn't present. I did hear myself say, oh, Abby, I'm so sorry. Oh my gosh, I'm so sorry. I can't believe I missed that. You're right, I said all the right things, but I wasn't present with her. Here's where I went. By the way, the more identity we have about who we are in the world. And for me, in this instance, my father raised me by himself. My parents were divorced when I was 2. I don't have a template for motherhood, but I know I want to be a good mother. And I overrow the boat, so I've got a good chance. But I want to be a good mom. It's part of what I need to do in this lifetime is be a good mom and show up for my kids. So here's where I went. The first place I went was shame. And my inner dialogue was, I cannot believe I did this. What are you thinking, traveling around, working with all these fancy men, talking about grandiosity? You'll never see them again. Who cares if they get to go home to better lives? You suck. You are awful. You don't have your priorities straight, Susan. This is me, right? Angry at myself. Pause. Where the hell was her father? Do I have to do everything around here? Really? Where was he? Pause. I gotta rethink this whole work-life thing because clearly it's not working for me. And I'm just gonna have to find a way to make a living doing the work that I do without traveling and being home. And I gotta be more focused because I missed the writer celebration. We missed the writer celebration. And oh my God, I was that parent. And oh my God, I have to look in the eyes of every other mother who did make it and be the one who didn't. I'm that mother. Pause. You know, we pay a lot of money for this nanny to go through these schedules and look in the back. Is anyone looking in the backpack when I'm traveling? It really is all up to me, isn't it? I gotta track months ahead. I gotta run the whole thing. You know, I get coached by my coach not to overrow the boat. Well, look what happens when I don't overrow the boat. Pause. And back and forth I go, right? So here's the lesson. I first gotta stop the madness, and I got something kind of sad to share with you. What snapped me out of my whirlwind, and it was an internal whirlwind. It was just stressing me out, was Abby Brady climbs into my lap. I think it's 2 hours after I picked her up at school this day. 2 hours. Somehow, all this dialogue, I mean, I think I unpacked my clothes, I think I cleaned up my house and made dinner. All the while, nothing was going on around me other than my own, like, story in my, you know, in my head. And I sat down again to just apologize to her. And she said, "Mama, it's okay. It's okay, there'll be other writer celebrations." And then I knew. Damn it, I teach this. When the people who we've hurt start comforting us, we are in a shame attack. When the people who we've hurt start comforting us, we are in a shame attack. And it literally snapped me awake to be present. And I was like, okay, breathe. I gotta hold myself in warm regard. That is not this little girl's job, for crying out loud. I missed her writer celebration. Now she's comforting me. That's not her job. So look, I gotta press pause. Is Jamie Brady really, really a bad guy? I just left for 4 days. Yes, the nanny comes in the morning to help with the stuff, and he's working full time, working his tail off. The nanny's doing the best she can. I don't like to manage people at home, and I just let them figure it out, and then I feel disappointed when they don't do what I want them to do. So it's not really the nanny's fault. Like, I could have given more direction there. So, like, I'm now down pretty certainly off of my one-up high horse. And then to her, I have to say something very, very, very intense. To her, the part of me that's in shame, I have to actually channel, because I can't get compassionate with 43-year-old Susan in this moment. I can't. I can't drum it up. It's too painful for me, because I suck that bad as a mother. So what I do is I think about the little dorky 7-year-old with glasses and curly red hair, who's like high waters, because my dad, like, didn't buy me long enough pants. And to her, I can look over and say, "Oh, honey, it's okay. It's okay. It's not going to be the first time you mess up. It's not going to be the last time. You are perfectly imperfect. You are the perfect mother for Abby Brady. It's okay. That's my job. And if I have to call myself honey to do it, well, I will." Right? Whatever channels the compassionate side of myself so that I can bring myself back into warm regard, I do. And I tell my kids, too. So I think maybe the most salient piece of advice I have for you today is the following. Do not speak, do not seek to repair, don't make a request until you are back at this center place, right? So it's prescriptive and descriptive. You want to bring yourself up from shame into compassion with yourself and others. You want to bring yourself down from grandiosity into compassion with others by getting curious. Here's why. Okay, hypothetically, Jamie Brady comes in the door, okay? I am 2 hours into my massive fest after missing Abby's writer celebration, and I'm sitting there, and he just comes in from a hairy day, and I'm one down in shame. How's that gonna go? How's that gonna go? Not good. Not good. Here's why. Anything short of Jamie Brady not changing his clothes, getting a bite to eat because he's always hungry, right? Anything short of him coming straight to me, "Oh, honey, you're a fabulous mother. Stop this. And you look particularly pretty today." Anything short of that, what would have happened? He can't even comfort me in my hour of need. I am on my own around here, emotionally, with scheduling. That's not going to work so well. So it is my job, not my mother's or my manager's or my colleagues or my husband's or my daughter's, to take myself from that pity party and bring myself into warm regard with myself. How about this? What would have happened if, figuratively or literally, I had my hands on my hips when Jamie Brady walked in the door? Like this. I used to work with someone who talked about normal marital hatred. No one's ever asked what that is, by the way. So what would have happened if Jamie Brady walked in the door and I was raring to go? Bad, 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 bad. I have some friends who have the type of husband who would have been, who have seen this, who would have sniffed it, and they would have like diverted, right? Right? Not my husband. No, no. He would have come right at me. Like, "Are you kidding me? I have been here for four," you know, we would have been, the technical term is off to the races. And so that doesn't work for us either, me standing there, either figuratively or literally, with my hands on my hips. We've been married 20 years. I've done that. I've been to that movie before. It's not pretty. So I got to come down off my high horse and think, you know, he's not out to get me. It's okay. We can do this. And so I do. And so when he does come home and I'm at center and I'm reflecting on how this whole thing hit me, what I realize is Brené Brown's research, anyone know who Brené Brown is? She's a vulnerability and shame researcher out of the University of Houston. I love her work. She wrote a great book called Daring Greatly. She's on YouTube. Go find her. She's awesome. She did some research about the difference between how men and women experience shame. And what she found really is like so perfect for the story I just told, because what she found is that when women experience shame when we feel like we are not enough. I mean, that's every day for me. We're set up. When men experience shame, it's because they are in a position where they feel weak. So Jamie didn't feel weak by missing Abby's writer celebration. What he said was, "Oh, God, okay. All right, well, it's probably not the first, last one we'll miss, you know, we'll do better next time." To which I had to be like, "Oh, okay." You know, but it's interesting because he didn't get triggered the same way at all. At all. Okay, this is my husband. This is Jamie. I am enough and I matter, and so is he, as it turns out. we talk a lot about this at home. This is Abby and Caroline. Abby is on the left. Caroline's on the right. When I told them yet again, I'm going to tell the story, this story, you know, Caroline's response is, "Mom, why can't you tell any of the stories about when you disappointed me?" So much material, so little time. Sorry, honey. Okay, so as Rachel said, we put together, I wrote a little book called The 30-Second Guide to Coaching Your Inner Critic, and it is little on purpose. If you want to find out about emotional intelligence, understanding self, the root of shame, there are thousands and thousands of books where you can get more knowledgeable about the background of anything I've talked about. If you want to, this moment, right here, right now, begin your moment-to-moment practice of coaching your inner critic and stopping the nonsense, this little 26 pages of illustrated love. Now, the four practices are, first, become aware. We know what that looks like. Second, push pause. Stop the madness. Third, be compassionate. Channel as you need to, how you need to. And last, get curious. This is particularly valuable for those of you who maybe ride one up, who need to get aware of your own self-righteous indignation. We all have it. It turns out you cannot be grandiose and genuinely curious at the same time. You can't be grandiose and genuinely curious at the same time. So I hope these practices help. So now that you know that I play with my hair too much in public, and that I can be the eye of my very own storm, you know that I've missed an important event in my daughter's life, and that it's not outside the realm of possibility that I will miss another. I hope I don't. You actually know what being human looks like. It's right, it's here. You also know that I have stumbled not understanding the impact of my own intensity. I can be reactive. I have let others down by taking on way too much, moving too fast, over-rowing whatever boat I'm in. I've been harsh with myself and others and critical and sometimes still am. I've questioned myself over and over and over and over. But here's the thing. I have also found my belief in my own worth and in the worthiness of others. This belief has changed my life. I practice this work imperfectly, being less than gentle and kind with myself, and sometimes others too. My inner critic is in fact waiting for me as I get off the stage with like balloons and streamers to tell me about like the one thing I should have said or the other thing that I should probably never say in public again. And to her, I have this to say. Girl, it's okay. It's okay. We did good. We did our best. We'll do better next time. So I have a call to action for all of you. Make moment-to-moment choices to live in a place of warm regard for yourself and for others. This is a return to compassion, not a resting spot. Your clues are the critical thoughts and feelings you have in your mind. And if you take seriously your pursuit of understanding self, taking on the questions in the seven hurdles, and particularly if you take seriously the moment-to-moment practice of coaching your inner critic, you will be unstoppable. The time is now. Right now. The world needs us. Thank you very much.
The standing ovation that was here a minute ago is one that I have for you too, because you changed my life the first time I heard that, and I want to be a better person on that message. Thank you on behalf of Linkage for bringing that content forward, and behalf of this room. Really important. For those of you who are interested in understanding the 7 questions of understanding self, please take this with you. This is another reference tool and guide for you. We call it part of your materials for the week. And this is something that we'd like you to talk about in your learning teams. This is something we'd like you to make sure that you are unpacking as a team, these 7 hurdles. Looking ahead, if someone could advance a slide for me. Do we have the ability to advance slides? Thank you. Let's continue the conversation. I am best when I am. This is our Twitter conversation for the day, inspired by Susan's sentiments. It's okay, we're good. Thank you. So let us know, when are you at your best? I'd like to hear, and I'll contribute myself.